So the summer beard is ready for a trim. It looks like September's just around the corner, so it's time for our next education in chemistry. And this month we're going to be visiting a demonstration that has caused some life-changing injuries in the US and has even had some calls for it to be banned. But there's absolutely no reason for this demonstration to be banned as long as we're doing the experiment safely and paying attention especially to the choice of solvent. It's recently been revisited by Peter Hoare and Cleeps have issued a new risk assessment to accompany this demonstration, so I thought it's worthwhile flagging up. This is Rainbow Flames. So the main trick to doing this demonstration safely is going to be down to solvent choice. A lot of injuries have been caused by using methanol in the past. We're going to be using ethanol today. Number one, there's absolutely no reason to be using methanol. It has an incredibly low flash point and it's actually toxic as well. So ethanol is going to be a much better choice for us to be using. Also notice that I only need like a maximum of 50 mil for this demonstration. So I'm not going to be bringing a whole Winchester load of ethanol into the lab with me. This is as much as I actually want to be around. And the last thing, of course, absolutely never, ever, ever pour straight from the bottle onto the experiment after it's begun. We'll talk a little bit more about that later on. Okay, so to get me started, I have a number of salts here. I've actually sort of arranged them roughly in order of color for the rainbow, but that's not obviously essential. And into the bottom of each one of these borosilicate beakers, I've placed 2 to 3 grams of the solid. Borosilicate, important to be using here to make sure that the heat that is being generated is not going to cause any cracks. Watch glasses would be a really poor choice for this experiment because they tend to be made from soda glass. It's likely that they will crack and spill burning ethanol over your desk, which of course you don't want to be happening. So having spread 2 or 3 grams of the solid across the bottom, then you just want to dampen each of the solids with about 0.5 mil of water. I'm going to do that now. And then onto each one, you're going to be using about 6 mil of ethanol. Work on a heat-resistant mat for the demonstration, and it would be handy to have somebody ready nearby some light switches to get the room darkened for you so that you can actually get the best effect off of some of these flames. So now I've got my beakers all loaded up with solvent. Next thing to do is to make sure I remove the solvent at least 3 meters away from where the demonstration is taking place. So I'm going to completely remove the bottle. And at the same time, because I'm plugged in here with a microphone, I'm going to use that opportunity to make the room a little bit darker so that we can enjoy this experiment at the best possible condition that we can. Okay, so lights are down. I've got a meter rule with a splint attached. My audience are 3 meters away. I'm going to be using the meter rule to light these up. Let's enjoy the rainbow flames. So there we go, rainbow flames. Now, before you go, the main risk associated with this demonstration is when teachers attempted to pour solvent straight back onto a flame that they think has extinguished. Potentially it has, but these beakers are going to stay hot for at least 15 minutes afterwards. Make sure you do not ever pour solvent straight back onto these beakers. Leave them 15 minutes or so. But If you've done that, then actually these beakers can be kept and reused exactly as they are. It's a really quick and simple demonstration to set up, with the exception of the copper, which will thermally decompose. So that one actually you would potentially collect and dispose of, but the other beakers you can keep as they are. One last thing before we go though, I got a new toy over the summer and I was really excited by this. It's a little computer spectrometer, and I thought, well, this would be a great demonstration to try and sort of see what kind of data I can get from some of these flames. I was particularly interested in the potassium flame, because I was like, I know that the red line associated with lithium is that nearest P down to the S transition, and we get that nice, bright, famous sodium P back down to the S transition. Why isn't there this sort of same thing going on? Why is it that potassium is such a poor flame color by comparison? And then when I pointed the spectrometer at the flame, I was like, I can't believe I didn't think of this before. It was so cool. Because I looked there, and there's this, instead of seeing lots of transitions around the purple end of the spectrum, I saw this massive transition down in the red. It's the same P to the S transition. I was like, there's got to be something wrong with this spectrometer, until I looked more closely at the numbers, and it was borne out, of course, when I went and checked out the actual data for potassium. That same P to S transition is there. It's just beyond the range of visible light to the human eye. And so what we're seeing here with the purple light coming from the potassium are actually those far more infrequent transitions down from the higher orbitals above that nearest P. Which explains, of course, why it's a paler transition, because they're happening far more infrequently. And those transitions are actually taking place in the sodium and the lithium as well. But of course, they're being masked by those brighter lines coming from that very common P down to S transition. So rainbow flames, it still can teach me a few things. And I really hope it can enthuse your students as well. Don't let this demonstration die. It can be done safely. Get in touch with Cleeps if you want any special guidance, and let's keep that flame burning for rainbow flames. Thanks.